BJ, I'm so excited to have our next guest on, and they're now Hall of Famers. Please welcome to the show Mike McCready and Stone Gossard of Pearl Jam.
Hello, how are you?
They look the same to me, Steve. I thought for sure there'd be some sort of halos, glows, a sheen, some sort of aura. But
a ring, nothing.
Yeah,
we're still as desperate as always. We were here outside. Nobody was here for about an hour. Yeah. We were outside waiting to be
We got here
in.
Really early to talk about ourselves.
Yeah.
So
again, we are teamed up with KISW for the Vitalogy Foundation, our third year in a row, and we've raised a bit of cash, and I'm very excited because, and I don't know, I mean, the cool thing is that, you know, the Vitalogy Foundation, very important to you guys, and I always like to ask you why, because I think it's great for people to hear why in your lives, everything you got going on, why you said, hey, we're going to start this foundation. Why is it that important to you guys?
I think it's pretty simple. We've been so fortunate and blessed and have been able to do what we want to do with music and our band, and we've had a lot of success financially and all those things, and I think one of the easiest decisions we ever made was, you know, do we want to give some money away, and do we want to make sure that we're sort of putting money back into the communities where we play and sell tickets and all those kinds of things. So, you know, 15 years ago, I guess, something like that, when we started Vitalogy. And it's probably become one of the central, most important things in the organization. I mean, we have conversations about it all the time. We're constantly giving money away. We're constantly finding new organizations to support and connecting organizations together that we enjoy with other donors. Mike has been a relentless fundraiser for multiple organizations. He's done amazing work over the last, you know, 5 and 10 years. He's just
been busy.
So many groups.
Last weekend,
and
yeah.
I think really
yeah.
everyone in the band has had
thanks, Tom.
A lot of different organizations they've been aligned with that they really want to support. And it's honestly, it makes this whole thing make sense. You know, you can have all the stuff you want and, you know, but when it comes down to actually putting money back in the community and helping other people, I think it makes your life more important. It makes it more interesting. It makes it a better life.
And I think that over the years we've been trying to make this Vitalogy idea become more efficient, and Nicole Vandenberg has helped us do that, and you learn it by doing it and splitting money in different ways, and now we've got it kind of down to pretty as efficient as it can be, and now we get to partner with you guys, and that's huge for us to be able to be able to partner with you guys and raise more money for all these.
It's super huge for us as well. Yeah. I'd love to be able to work with you guys and to be able to, you know, do Pain in the Grass, selling tickets and being
That's
able to...
That's amazing for
yeah,
us.
Yeah, for people, you know, to buy their tickets and then, oh yeah, that goes to a great cause as well.
Yeah. So yeah, they know bucks. That you're doing a good thing, and you're just buying tickets. So,
it's Mike, you've been so busy with some stuff outside of Pearl Jam that I'm geeking out about. A, you've got the Polaroid picture book that's coming out.
Yeah.
Yeah, which I pre-ordered of Potato Heads and
Great.
Polaroids. I can't wait to see. I know our mutual friend Craig Gass has been geeking out because he's in the book.
He's in there. Yeah, he's in there.
He made it a point to let me know.
Oh, of yeah. course he did. Yes.
Well, he's everywhere. He's like the Forrest Gump of rock. I mean, he's everywhere.
He's the.
He really is. I mean, it's a great.
Yeah, that's very good. Yeah, I'm excited about that Polaroid book. It's going to be fun. It's been 20 years of taking, you know, about 1,000 Polaroids and going through it. And, you know, there's elements of all the band, and there's elements of famous people that have shown up, and there's art. There's all sorts of stuff. So. And then I'm glad to finally have it somewhere.
And then on top of that, you've also been in the world of producing and bringing new music to the world, a band that I've been geeking out about.
Yes.
Which has been funny. We're having this off-air conversation on how do we say the name, which is ridiculous, but it's Thunder P.
I'm going to say Thunder. I don't know why I can't say the name Thunder Pussy, but that's the name of the band that I've been... we've had a president that said certain things that are kind of along those lines, so it doesn't quite make sense to me why we couldn't say that. And... they're a fantastic band, and I've been producing them. So I you know, just a single right now, and so, you know, hopefully everybody gets to hear the song Velvet Noose, and it's they're just the real deal. So,
and BJ, I think you're gonna love the. I grabbed a clip of the song.
Oh yeah,
I want people to hear it because I think this band is just phenomenal.
I agree
that you've wrapped your arms around them, and I just love that you guys. You know, you don't need to do that, but you do because you love music.
I love bands that inspire me. You know, and they're inspiring, and I need that because I'm 51. You know, so it's like it's really cool.
It is a good point, Mike. It really, really is.
Yeah. We have a clip from the song.
Let me hear this band, man.
Velvet Noose. This is out. Check them out.
Can you hear me breathing? Why do you want to see it? From that building,
there's a lot there.
Right?
There's a
right?
lot. There's a lot mashed in that
they
situation.
They have a lot of great energy and, yeah, a lot of stuff. So that was fun.
This may be a silly question to ask then. Like, how does that, like, I mean, A, how do you discover this band? And B, what made them connect with you as opposed to other bands?
You know, it's interesting. I saw them at Sasquatch 2 years ago, and they were just, they played at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and they just were killing it. And I'm, you know, and I, when I see a band like that, I'm immediately energized and excited and good songwriting. And I think they're playing like a Peter Green song, and which is totally not of their era. So, and I thought that was rad, and they were killing it. So,
so are you waiting for them on the side of the stage? Like, hey, kids, I've got a contract to sign.
No, I actually I got them in this Polaroid book. I said, hey, can I take some Polaroids of you? And they were cool. And I did. And then, just after that, I said, hey, would you like to, you know, do a 45? With my label, and they were into it, and so we just went from there.
You know, how what could the answer be but yes to that question?
You know, you never know that one. Yeah, it's, you know, it's that's I'm glad that they said yes. You know,
yeah. I mean, because you'd be. I mean, look, I know you. I mean, we've talked about it before. That's what I love.
I have
about
a lot of energy. Let's put it that way. That's why. Yeah. Go ahead, BJ.
Yeah,
sorry.
Well, I just what I love about you guys is you forget who you are. I mean, or maybe you don't, in a way you don't even know who you are to other people. So you come up to a band that's hoping maybe somebody is listening. Somebody. 1 o'clock in the afternoon, like you said, not exactly the prime time for any festival.
Not at all.
And all of a sudden, here's a Mike McCready going, hey, look, I don't know, man. What do you think if you could... you know, and it's just, I guess it would be, you know, if some luminaries from your life as you were growing up.
Yeah, that would be
you.
Cool. Well, it was exciting for me because I've not really produced anybody, so that was a thing. And they were receptive to ideas, but yet have their own conviction on what they want to do. So I like that.
Did that give you a newfound appreciation for producers that have worked with you guys? Because, I mean, sometimes...
Oh, for sure, yeah.
Yeah, because you don't know. Maybe you drove producers crazy and you didn't realize, and now here you are in that situation.
What do you think about our whole producer thing at times?
I'm sure we've driven... Yeah. Producer's crazy, and when I say droven, I mean.
I like droven though. You know, we're going to use droven. We're keeping it. We're making
it
a word.
I can see all the cars droven on the road right now.
It's a whole new world, like you said. We have a whole new president. We're going to droven this whole country right where we need to droven.
I'm going to copyright that term.
We're droven this interview right into the ground. That's what's happening.
Well, first off, somebody from Twitter said, "Hey, any chance anyone gets to see Pearl Jam play anytime soon?"
That was Ryan from Twitter that asked.
Thank you, Ryan.
What did we say last time?
Yeah, I forget.
I'll let Stone do the diplomatic answer on this one because he's better.
We have to always ask, even though, you know, we know, but at least there's somebody on Twitter.
I would say yes. There is no plans though right now. We're trying to write right now and make a record. So we're
Really? Okay, that's
just
a nice
trying
thing.
To write some new songs, and we're pretty focused on hometown hanging. So we'll get to. Getting some shows here.
Yeah, I imagine if there's a new record, there's always shows to follow. Yeah,
absolutely.
That's a nice thing.
Talking a lot here at the station about the 25-year anniversary of the single soundtrack and the movie singles, and last year we had a chance to talk with Cameron Crowe. He shared some incredible stories of just the experience of putting the movie together. For you guys now, I know it's looking back 25 years ago, but do you have any favorite memories from the whole, just the way singles came out and being a part of the soundtrack?
For me, it was just, you know, it was the whirlwind of the scene kind of blowing up in terms of the dreams that are coming true, and then the manicness of it, and trying to, you know, get our band off the road get on the road. And it was captured a time just from my period of time when I was younger. And I remember that what I really love on that soundtrack is Birth Ritual by Soundgarden. It's just like the coolest song. And I remember hearing that and going, those guys are really good. So,
it was cool to see the inside of making movies. You know, you go into see the detail that they go into making those sets, and how much detail Cameron got in terms of just sort of, you know, just looking at how musicians in Seattle were kind of living at that time, and really making the movie just spot on in terms of just the details of all of it, the artistic details that he went to make it legitimate and sort of feel right. And that was pretty interesting to see that, you know, sort of how movies were made and sort of the process that they go through and how many people it takes to make a movie and how long it takes.
So we're talking to Mike and Stone, Pearl Jam, and you guys, of course, in the Hall of Fame. The question I ask, I don't know how it works, but do you get to pick who inducts you, or is that somebody else? So that's not you. You guys had, because it was Neil Young, and then he couldn't make it.
Yeah.
And I mean, look, for a lot of folks that didn't understand how much David Letterman loved the band, but a lot of folks thought David Letterman. Yeah. They really didn't know that, you know, here's this old guy. What would he care? But in fact, he was a huge supporter of what you guys did back when you came out.
Yeah, we were on his show maybe 8 or 9 times, and it always seemed like every year we'd almost play it. So, and he was very supportive, and at the last minute was able to do it, and he was super funny, and we had a great time being inducted by him, for sure.
In terms of significance in David Letterman, when I look at it, my comedy and how I perceived comedy was informed by David Letterman, for sure, and I think some of our early humor was that, and I don't know. So that was kind of a thing for me personally to have him do that. You know, of course, Neil Young would have been amazing, but again, that they choose all that stuff.
I was bummed that they edited out on the broadcast. They edited out Eddie's story of having Dave talk to him through the television.
Oh yeah,
oh man, that was because I saw the bootleg video originally, and then
they edited a lot out of that. Yeah. Out of that,
it's a 5-hour show, so I think it's a 5 or 6. So they have to. Concise.
If only they had more HBO channels to put it on. You know,
I know.
Only like 30 HBO channels.
Maybe that'll happen someday in the future. We'll have more channels of the TV that we can watch.
Was it difficult to pick what songs to play for the induction?
Not particularly. I mean, we kind of went back and forth on it a few, but we knew we were going to play some sort of classic era stuff, and it was probably maybe 6 that we were sort of really considering, and we kind of just, at the end, we sort of let Ed figure that out.
And, yeah. And, you know, Dave Cruzan played with us on that first record, so that was kind of something off the first record was one of those obvious choices, I believe.
Was that fun for you guys to have Dave behind the kit and see him again?
It was just good to see him again. Yeah, it was really fun. And to kind of compare and contrast the feel of both Matt and him, and they're both awesome in different ways, and it was cool to see him again.
Yeah. And I know that you guys aren't so much about awards, and a lot of people even wonder, you know, whether a lot of people really question even the legitimacy sometimes of the Grammy Awards. But this is the Hall of Fame. And when you both started out and loved music and had your idols and greatness and people you really, really said, okay, this tends to, I think, I mean, did you tend to think, okay, we are... Wow, we have become what we loved, and that is, I guess, pure artist. Was that part? Was any of that there for the Hall of Fame? Not so much the award, but the idea that you got to be perhaps what you admired when you first started out. Did that enter? Because that's what I would think, getting to that level when someone says you're a Hall of Famer. That, oh wow, I got to be what I loved about this business when I first started, and it's just creating the great art. Did that hit you at all?
I think that, you know, for me it was a significant big deal, and I felt very proud of being, you know, inducted and see. I remember seeing the first one. I remember seeing the Stones be inducted and all that kind of stuff, and with Iggy and being at a few of those and getting to jam with Heart. So in terms of those bands that I looked at growing up, and now maybe we're in that same thing in terms of perception, I'm very proud of that and excited. And it's for me personally, it's changed kind of my perception, like the singles, actually like the Pearl Jam movie did, that Cameron did, of our band, whereas the movie made me look at our career in more of a linear sense, and then the highs and lows, where I hadn't looked at it that way before. And then the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has looked at, now we're in this thing, you know, we're in this club of that I'm proud of to be in.
And how about you, Stone? How did that hit you? Because you know, you never know what a guy thinks of because he's in the middle of what he's doing. How does that hit you, just the idea that, okay, we think you're a Hall of Famer?
I generally feel so, it's like it's been such a dream that kind of we've succeeded, that I kind of feel like sometimes those things can kind of wake you up from your dream. And and so in a sense, I sort of was nervous about it, and just feeling like, I don't know if this feels right now, or I just felt like, you know, I'm happy, of course, I'm flattered, but I also feel like I so much want to continue to make records with this band. I so much want this dream to continue and just to feel the way it has and to grow, that I don't want to have anything that shakes it out of its it's something that like might stir it in some way that doesn't, you know, that wakes you up and suddenly it's not there anymore. So I guess I had some trepidation about it, and in the end it felt great. It was great to have Jack Irons there. It was great to have Dave Cruzan there and all these friends. It was great to be able to thank everyone that we've worked with and really just focus on gratitude and just the feeling of like, okay, we're going to accept this, and we're going to accept it on behalf of all the other bands we love and all of our friends and our families and all of that
stuff.
And
how great the crew is and great our whole organization is that surrounds us.
So that's what I focused on. That's what I kept thinking about. And that's what made it good, you know. You know, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in general, you could probably put like 10 bands in there and close it, and it would probably be okay. You know what I mean? Like, there's a logic that to me that just says, you know, like, seriously, it's not everybody, but so I'm
we have opposing views on it.
Yeah. And I know we got to let you guys run, but I also want to thank you guys, and I know my wife wouldn't want to thank you for this, but because I've spent several $100 already there at Easy Street Records, you've got that awesome Pro Jam pop-up shop.
Oh, yeah.
Which is just, I don't know if you had a chance to swing by
Of course, awesome. All the guys in the band, I was there, I went and saw it, and I sat there in the corner waiting to take pictures with people, and begging people to take pictures, and nobody wanted to take pictures with me. And I kind of, I don't know.
Oh my God.
There's
that's class.
People are very polite. They're polite.
I'm just kidding. I didn't really do it, but I did go by. Yeah, I did go by. Yeah. Hey, does anybody notice me looking through our section?
Yeah, that's awesome.
Why hello?
I just happened to be here again.
Yeah. It'd be great. You walk in. Oh, where's the Pearl Jam section?
Yeah. Hey, where's the? Yeah, it's super loud.
A personal meet and greet to take you to the Pearl Jam section. That's fair.
Over this way.
Every time someone has one of your records, would you like me to sign it?
Seriously, who are you? What, me? I play guitar on the.
I wrote this song.
Hang on. Well, the real story behind it is just totally. Just keeping okay. Anyways, but yes, I'm excited about that. And Easy Street did a great job of it.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And you know, guys, like Steve, so we got to let you go. What I took from the Hall of Fame, and I wonder if this is for the fans, is that years ago when they first resonated with the first Pearl Jam song they heard and it spoke to them, and you know what it's like when you're young and you feel like you have something that's meaningful, that's important, that really like inspires you and sparks you, and others around you tell you that's ridiculous, it's insignificant, what's wrong with you. It's moments like this years later where you go, you know what, I knew I was onto something, I knew there was something special, something hopeful, something inspiring. And when you see finally the rest of the world acknowledge that in some way, shape, or form, I think it legitimizes the fact that, hey, you know what? I was onto something that young at that time of my life where I knew I wanted something better. And this band helped me see that, yes, I'm on the right track. Because that's what art does. It inspires you to make a change. Mm-hmm. And I love watching where you guys started, where you are now, and where you're about to go. Because you don't always get to see that because bands don't stay together for that long. It's great to see where you guys go.
Thank you.
Very nice.
Yeah. And so congratulations for all that, guys.
I think the key to it is the collaborative art. You know, I mean, the fact that all of us did it together and we stuck through it, that's, I think, what the significant talent that we had. We have some talents for sure, but I think our talent really was just continuing to believe in the ideals that we sort of set up when we first started being a band, and what we first loved about music, and what we first loved about, you know, being in bands where it's like a brotherhood, and it really isn't about you got to get the, you know, new guys in, and you got to get new this and that, and it just was, we just fought for each other, and it's hard. It's like, you know, it's every day you don't wake up and think this is perfect. You wake up and go, I got to make this a little better.
Yeah, and so you take that micro and turn that into a macro for humanity. That is not bad at all. Not bad at all. Guys, thanks so much for coming in. Mike McCready, Stone Gossard, Pearl Jam, and again, the Vitalogy Foundation. $2 from every ticket sold from Pain in the Grass goes to support that, and it's a great thing. More info at KISW.com.